I think a lot of times when we think of, you know, quote unquote cartoon music, we think of music that's, you know, ostensibly children's music or music that sounds like it should be written for children. I realize that's sort of the expectation maybe, but I try to play against that as much as possible. I try to make the music not play young. And it's almost like I'm writing for the parents of the children who have to watch the show with their kids and would be otherwise bored out of their minds. Hi, my name is Vivek Maddala. I'm a film and TV composer. I also produce records and play in a variety of different bands. I'm here talking to you today about some television and film programs that I'm working on, and we can dive into my DAW sessions and look in some detail about how I write and how I produce recordings. So I didn't come from a particularly musical family, but my family was fairly supportive. I started playing music when I was a small child. I started playing piano when I was 3 and drums when I was 7. I started playing, I guess, bass when I was around 10 and guitar when I was 12. And it's always been a big part of my life ever since I was old enough to even have any knowledge of what music was or any knowledge of melody and rhythm and harmony. Interestingly, I think I was kind of a born producer. I remember being a little kid, I must have been 3 or 4. This would have been like maybe, I don't know, late 70s, early 80s. I remember hearing a Bee Gees song on the radio and being very critical of, like, there's too many 16th notes. The Feel the City Breaking and Everybody Shaking. I was like, there's too many 16th notes stacked up against each other. That's not, you know, it's a silly idea. But as far back as I can remember, I remember being very analytical about music and thinking about how they must have mic'd the snare drum to get that sound, or the intonation on these vocals could have been better, or wow, I really like the stereo imaging on the strings and the brass on this orchestral recording, or things like that. So I've always kind of thought like a producer and thought like a composer, even before I knew what record production was, or certainly before I knew that there was a thing called film scoring. I think a lot of times when we think of, you know, quote unquote cartoon music, we think of music that's, you know, ostensibly children's music or music that sounds like it should be written for children. I realize that's sort of the expectation maybe, but I try to play against that as much as possible. I try to make the music not play young. And it's almost like I'm writing for the parents of the children who have to watch the show with their kids and would be otherwise bored out of their minds. So there's a kind of a harmonic sophistication that I think belies what you're seeing. You know, the music is doing a lot. It's obviously playing the physical action on screen, but in addition, it's also filling out some of the emotional backdrop and sometimes foreshadowing things. The characters on screen are literally two-dimensional characters, and so we have this opportunity maybe to flesh them out more. The kind of the musical vocabulary that I'm drawing from is maybe much more kind of harmonically complex than the equivalent of what you're seeing, which is why I tend to, you know, I tend to use kind of a harmonic language that maybe is not really congruent with the visual, but I think it still works. It still works in some way. So this is one where I did a lot of drums on it as well.
It's a high flying and deep left, that one might be gone.
basically one big band cue sculpted to the episode. And there's just all the piano in it is emotional piano. We're at my studio here in West LA. We're in the piano room. We're starting here and we'll move back into the main studio momentarily. This is the Yamaha C3 grand piano that I have with the disclavier option. I'm doing audio over LAN using the Dante network and also MIDI over LAN so I can send and receive MIDI information to this piano. I've got it always mic'd up with these Earthworks PM40 mics, and I have additional mics that I can set up for a total of 8 mics on this piano. Different configurations for different kinds of sounds. This is sort of set up right now for a very sort of immediate kind of studio polished jazz sound. So with the disclavier, if you're not familiar with it, what it allows you to do is it allows you to actually record MIDI data that you can play back. There's little servo motors and lasers for sensing the location of the keys. So for example, if I wanted to play a passage like, okay, let me just send MIDI data. So this is the studio. It's a two-story structure that took about 3.5 years to design and get the permits for and build. It's actually still kind of a work in progress, but I moved in and started working here about 3 years ago. So it's been a great tool. And let's go inside and I'll give you a quick peek inside. So the building was based on a double shell construction, so the outside shell is acoustically decoupled from the inside rooms. This is where I spend about 16, 18 hours a day. It's the main composing studio, and it's acoustically neutral down to about 28 hertz, so no matter where you are in the room, you'll hear about the same thing, which is great because typically I have when I have clients in here, like say a director and a producer, editor, normally people would be hearing different things, but because the room is acoustically tuned to be essentially neutral down to about 28 hertz, no matter where you are in the room, you're going to be hearing about the same thing. So if you've ever studied modern physics or particle dynamics, you're probably familiar with the wave equation. It's a second order partial differential equation that describes the propagation of waves through a given medium. In this case, the Rayleigh solution of the wave equation applies to a rectangular box, which is basically what this room is. So we can predict and minimize room resonances, room modes, standing waves, peaks, nulls, by applying the Rayleigh solution to the wave equation and then addressing those issues. So one of the things we've done is we've built this bass trap. I call it a bass trap, but it's really an everything trap. It's a broadband absorber. It's about 3 feet deep, and it allows the room essentially to be acoustically kind of sort of colorless or without a sonic fingerprint. Because it's essentially a perfect absorber, there are no reflections off that back wall, so it creates the effect acoustically of an infinitely long room, which is, you know, so that wall essentially disappears acoustically. So that's part of how the math works out in this room. Likewise, the ceiling disappears acoustically. The ceiling is also about 3 feet deep. And so we've got a large amount of air in between this floor and the next floor, which is the live room, which I'll take you on a tour of in a few minutes. Anything that generates noise is going to be located in the machine room. So that's obviously, you know, computer cooling fans and disk drives and things of that nature. Although I'm pretty much using solid state drives these days, but I do have a separate kind of isolated room in here for, like I said, anything that could possibly generate acoustic noise. So this is a purely utilitarian room. I've got my rack full of computers. These are all mostly custom machines that I've made for my DAWs. This is a separate temperature controlled and humidity controlled environment. So I can keep this room cool very easily, and it's fairly energy efficient because the room is small, and it's completely isolated from the main composing studio and also from the live room. So I pretty much have everything set up so that all the instruments are mic'd up and ready to go at any time. The drums are always mic'd up. I've got a particular kind of set of miking techniques that I'm using on the drums. I don't always use all the mics, but I have the ability to capture 2 to 3 mics on the kick. All the toms have their own dedicated mics. I've got a 3 mic setup on the snare. This is kind of an interesting little trick where I've got a 57 and the equivalent of a KM84 piggybacked on it. So I can get a very characteristic SM57 sound on the snare. I've got my large diaphragm tube mic, tube condenser here. It's a mic that I worked on a few years ago for Avid. That's sort of like a cross between a U47 and a C12 with a head amp that's kind of similar to the ELAM 251. It's a mic that I use on a lot of vocals, on acoustic guitar, on nylon guitar, on a variety of stringed instruments. So here we're in the live room, which also doubles as a dance studio. I don't know if you can see, but this is a sprung floor. And it's again acoustically decoupled from the rest of the building from the downstairs. We have these ballet bars that are height adjustable and removable. And the low frequency design of this room is identical to that of the room downstairs, as well as the piano room. So this is where I record any kind of chamber groups, strings 4-4-3-2-1 or 5-4-3-2 are common techniques that I use for strings, common group sizes, woodwind quintets, that sort of thing. I pretty much just react to things that move me or that I find interesting sonically, and then I'll go in and dive into the score and figure out what's going on. You know, even something as kind of elementary as like tritone substitutions in jazz progressions is something that I just happen to hear. And you know, the 2-5-1 sort of standard chord progression that we see all over the place, the fact that you can go to instead of going to the 5, you can go to the tritone and make it a dominant 7 chord and flat the 5, like that's, I think, probably fairly elementary jazz vocabulary that I never learned, but I heard it and then decided to go in and study and sort of deconstruct what was going on and why does that work and why does it sound the way it does and how does it cause the voice leading to work in the way that it does. All right, so right here, and by the way, this required some wood shedding for me to pull this off. So this is at 330 beats per minute. And I felt like that kid from Whiplash, because I was barely hanging on the drums. And it took a few passes on piano for me to get this. So that was the emotional piano. What's interesting about the emotional piano instrument is it is lush and beautiful, but it can be really agile as well. It's a really unusual combination because I don't find that often. Often I find if there's a virtual piano that allows me to be very, you know, to have a lot of dexterity, it can sound kind of cold when played with more legato passages. And then I've got others, you know, again, the emotional piano, it has this sort of characteristic sound that is just very kind of open, and it's got a very broad sound. But if I need to, you know, I can really move on this thing. And it's not sluggish. Thank you.